His love is marvelous for us, isn't it? Amen.
Yes, it is.
Oh, it's so good to see each one here tonight. I see some new faces. We met someone that came in today on a bicycle, saw it in the newspaper. And so we parked her car in my office. First time I ever had somebody park their car in my office that came to church. But we're so glad to have y'all with us tonight. We're looking forward to a great service. Have the Lord speak to our heart. This is the last night of the winter revival with the McGilliards, and this is the way we usually end it on a Friday night. And so you pray. Let's all pray together right now and ask God to bless this service. Oh, there they are.
Save me, could he
love me,
would he
take me,
did he
really,
can he, could he, would he, yes he can, he could, he would, and he did. Oh, can he
save me,
could he
love me,
would he
take me,
did he
really,
can he, could he, would he, yes he can, he could, he would, and he did.
From the moment I heard about the Lord and His word, well, it seemed a bit too good to be true.
There were questions and doubts, I tried to figure it out, but the best that I could do
was to wander around in the love that I found, until my questions started answering themselves, singing,
can he, could he, would he, yes he can, he could, he would, and he did.
Can he
save me,
could he
love me,
would he
take me,
did he
really,
can he, could he, would he, yes he can, he could, he would, and he did.
You can say you don't know, it's necessarily so, like somebody said it once in a song.
You can think what you choose, but let me tell you the news, the Lord has loved you all along. So if you're asking again, will the doubts never end? Simply trust him and you'll see for yourself, singing,
can he, could he, would he, yes he can, he could, he would, and he did.
Can he
save me,
could he
love me,
would he
take me,
did he
really, can he, could he, yes, he can, he could, he would, and he did.
Can he
save me,
could he
love me,
would he
take me,
did he
really,
can he, could he, would he,
yes, he can, he could, he would, and he did.
Can he
save me,
could he
love me,
would he
take me,
did he
really,
can he,
could he, would he, yes, he can, he could, he would, and he did.
Let me tell you what my Savior did.
Can he, could he, would he, yes he can, he could, he would, and he did. Can he, could he, would he, yes he can, he could, he would, and he did.
Can he, could he, would he, yes he can, he could, he would, and he did.
Amen. Amen. Oh, gotta watch Leroy there. He gets carried away sometimes. He's one of my favorite bass singers in all the world, him, Brother Lee. And but I'm glad, thank God, not only can he and could he, but I'm glad that goes on and says he did.
Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery.
Yeah.
All my life I've been told I belong. At the end of the line, will all the other not quite, will all the never get it right? But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
When Moses had stage fright, and David brought a rock to a sword fight, you picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is, everybody's got a purpose. who do you think you are? I say I'm just a nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Sometimes you win some, sometimes you lose some. And right now I'm losing bad. Stood on this stage night after night, reminding the broken it'll be alright. But right now, oh right now, I just can't. It's easy to say when there's nothing to bring me down. But what will I say when I'm held to the flame like I am right now? I know you're able and I know you can. They say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Well, good thing a little faith is all I have right now. God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be able. It is well with my soul. I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. I know the sorrow and I know the hurt would all go away if you just say but I know you care.
with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Some say, don't give up, and hope that your good is good enough. Head down, keep on working. If you can earn it, you deserve it. Some say, push on through. After all, it's the least that you can do. But don't buy what they're selling. It couldn't be further from the truth. Themselves and press on, get it right, otherwise get left behind. Yeah. Some say he's keeping score, so try hard, then try a little more. But hold up, if this were true, explain to me what the cross is for.
Oh, gospel. You don't need to sell it. It can change the hardest heart, but first you've got to tell it.
We've got the truth.
We've got the truth.
It's time to go.
It's time to go.
Son of God at Calvary.
put your hands together. Help us a little bit.
Well, I know that I know that I know that I know that I'm saved. And I'm sure as I'm sure it's gonna stay that way. There's no doubt I'm gonna shout about the fact my sin is in pain. Yes, I know I'm gonna go to heaven someday.
I've heard people say you can't know.
Yeah, I've heard them say that, hadn't you?
About where you're gonna spend eternity till it's your time to go. I say there's one problem, according to God's word. My name is written in the book of life, and by the blood it's been confirmed.
Yes, I know that I know that I know.
Do you know that you're saved?
And I'm sure as I'm sure it's gonna stay that way. There's no doubt I'm gonna shout about the fact my sin debt's been paid. Yes, I know I'm gonna go to heaven someday.
Well, if you don't know, you've come to the right place tonight. I don't know when or even how. Well, I could go through the door of death or riding upon a glory cloud. But one thing's for certain, by the Spirit I'm sealed. And naught of this world can make me question what the Word of God has instilled.
Yes, I know that I know that I know that I know that I'm saved.
Do you know that you're saved?
And I'm sure, yes, I'm sure it's gonna stay that way. There's no doubt I'm gonna shout about the fact my sin debt's been paid. Yes, I know that I know I'm gonna go to heaven someday.
Oh, let me tell you, friend, I am bound for the promised land.
I am bound for the promised land.
There's no doubt I'm gonna shout about the fact my sin has been paid. Yes, I know I'm gonna go to heaven someday. Yes, I know. Yes, I wish you would. All right. Well, we's only going to sing that one, but I've been threatening to let Sam and Madison sing. And they sang last night, but I love this song, and we don't get to hear it since they're not with us anymore. It's based out of Isaiah 53. There, God said he would see the travail of his soul, and he's talking about he saw what Jesus went through at Calvary. He said he'd see that and be satisfied. Thank God, God is satisfied. The only reason why somebody tries to add something else to that is because they're not satisfied. But tonight, I ask you the question of this song. Did Matthew write this?
Yes.
I love the question in this song. Hey, God's satisfied. If it's good enough for God, it's good enough for me.
That's not a question, but okay.
Yeah.
I struggled in my daily life, trying to attain favor in God's sight. From the glory of the Lord, sin left me falling short, I realized. Then I read how God is satisfied with the death that Jesus died. My pardon was signed. So who am I to question what the Father declares? Paid in full, the blood cleanses still. If it's good enough for God, it's good enough for me. His Son paid the ransom. Redemption's complete. I'll trust the finished work, not my ongoing deed. If it's good enough for God, it's good enough for today. I live with steadfast hope. Grace has firmly anchored my wandering soul. Though once tossed about by sin, now established within the crimson flow. I am resting in His sweet embrace. Traded works for childlike faith, dependent on God's sacred plan. For all things are accomplished, holy pages proclaim. Finish, Jesus cried with outstretched hands. If it's good enough for God, it's good enough for me. His Son paid the ransom. Redemption. Trust the finished work, not my ongoing deed. If it's good enough for God, it's good enough for me. I'll trust the finished work, not my ongoing deed. If it's good enough for God, it's good enough for me.
I think they've sung that since they've been here, but they didn't have the CD. You can buy it if you want to take it home with you. That way you can take Sam Madison home. We'll have to feed them. But we've got it on a CD back there because I love that song. It was talking about seeing at Calvary what Jesus did, and God saw it. He even likened it to travail. You know what travail is? That's the pangs that a woman goes through to bring a child into this world. And so that we might be children of God, Jesus died on Calvary, suffered those birth pangs for us. Now I'm glad, thank God, I'm His child. I'm glad, thank God, that Jesus loved me enough to die in my place. With that in mind, I really thought that tonight, since we're in February and headed close to, you know, few days from now, we'll be having Valentine's Day. And I thought, since I've already, in fact, I started talking to you the first service about how much God loves you and how that you and I need to show that love. Amen. And so I thought I'd do something to help you get an idea maybe of how much God loves you. I've got a locket there and on a chain, so you could hang it around your neck. That's what people do, you know, and they'll put pictures in there, and boy, they're in love with that other person. And of course, we always have hearts everywhere come Valentine's Day. And this one, it's got a special frame because, hey, real love is a wonderful thing. When you have the love that comes, not just a physical love, but that agape love that comes from the Father. Amen. From that heart of gold. In fact, I'm going to take this golden heart, push a little button on the side, open it up to see what's inside. You might not be able to see, but there's a mirror in there. You know what? If we could open the heart of God and look inside, that's what we'd see. How much He loves you and me. Amen. Well, I like to proclaim His love, and I'm thankful for those who, in their lives, they demonstrate that. After all, the Bible tells us that the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, it's like a man for his wife. Come on. Amen. And so I thought I'd illustrate something tonight. I asked Kim if she'd help with the pastor, but they thought she might not be able to be here, and I don't see her now anyway. But here came Maggie and her husband in tonight. I'm glad, thank God, Stan's with us. And I asked Maggie, I looked at her wedding ring. Come on. And I said, could I? She said, you want to use it? And I said, yeah, I want to use it. So I asked her if it would come off. Now, mine won't come off. It's grown in there. If I had to take it off, I don't know what I'd have to do. Probably cut the finger off. But she could get hers off. And I didn't realize, I remember these two back before they got married. And they'd come to hear us preach even before they got married. And go ahead and take that ring off. You're going to let me use it. That's it, that little wedding band. And she got little fingers anyway. But I tell you what, hand it to Stan. He gave it to you. You gave it to her, didn't you? How many years ago? Over 15 years ago. How about that? Amen. Well, that's a good record. I don't see how in the world anybody could live with her that long, but I'm just joking. I'm just joking. She's the one that let me use her ring. Stan, bring that up here for me, would you? And here's what I want to do. I want you just to stand right there, and you put it inside that locket. There you go. Put it in there, and then close up the locket. It'll snap closed. There you go. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Now stand right here for a minute. He has taken that symbol of their love. You know why we use a ring? For one thing, it goes round and round and round and round, never ends. And we ought to have a love that never ends. Amen? And it ought to be precious to us. Now, I saw that little ring as a precious thing. And that's their wedding band. Amen. I'm glad, thank God, I've got a band, you might say, with the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm glad, thank God, I'm His and He's mine. And He lives in my heart. In fact, the book of Colossians says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. If you don't have Christ in you, you have no hope of glory. Now watch this. I hope you watch this. Because He put the ring in the... Remember this, Maggie. He put the ring in there. I never touched it. In fact, He closed it up. It's in there. Now, some people take rings and hang them around chains on their neck or whatever. But watch this. I'm just going to take that locket, and I'm not going to touch it. Not going to touch it. I'm just put your hand out, brother. There you go, Stan. There you go. Shake that and see, does it wrap? Yeah, it's in there. Not too hard. You're liable to lose it. That's it. Just hold the locket. Now, go on back to your seat, I guess. Do not open that. Just hold it. You see, you're supposed to be taking care of that kind of thing. I'll get Brother Lee to move this. I'm going to preach here in just a moment. But, hold on to it. Like I said, He put it in there. It's safe. And ain't nobody touched it. I didn't even touch it, just the chain. All right. There it is. And I tell you what, I'm thankful for people who love one another. 15 years. In this old world today, that's almost an eternity. You know that? But I'm so thankful for people who mean it when they stand before God and they make vows. Amen. Well, He made those vows 15 years ago. On what day, Stan? What? June the what? Fourth. June. I just do that, put him on the spot. Make sure he remembers. Amen. You better. Let me tell you about me and Miss Becky.
Hey, Dad.
Hey, what? Wait a minute. That's been sitting over there the whole time.
It has, however.
Yeah, everybody's been watching
I've
it.
I've been also wanting to get a quarter this entire time.
You wouldn't want to.
You owe me for doing this, the guinea quarter.
Oh, crazy. Yeah.
That's about when I got paid. You know.
I was just fixing to say, anyway, I'm so thankful for homes that stay together. I was going to tell you about, wait a minute. I was telling about me and Miss Becky. And when we made our vows, I wasn't just making a vow to her. I was making a vow to God, amen. And get up from there, boy, get up from there. It's y'all's problem now. I've had the problem for so many years, but he's y'all's now. You want a quarter. No. I used to take him to the barber shop. Last time he got a haircut, I think, but
my hair is short
than yours. I'm teasing. They've got machines like this, and you go in there and put a quarter in it, turn it. Ah, you got what's in there?
It's a ring.
A ring.
What? It's pink. It's fake.
It's a little pink ring that you got. Now, hey, that's where you got the one from Madison, I think, in the first place.
It's kind of purple. I can sing the song.
Let me see the
purple
ring.
Purple ring, purple.
No, rain, get out of here. Let me see it. Yeah, well, now this one, it says T-I-N, a 10. You can give that to Madison, I guess. Probably
Merry
be,
Christmas,
probably
huh?
work,
it's, now.
It's probably worth more than the one you really got. No, not really. Well, it's a joke. It's a joke. Hang on to it. I tell you what we're going to do. Stan, come on. if Sam could do it, I guess you could do it. Put that quarter in there. Since that happened to be a quarter in that box, in that, turn it there, you go. Just turn it on around. Okay. Open that up. See if you can get that open. And there's a ring inside. Does that look familiar to you? I'll take the little capsule, and you can take her the ring back. Maggie, you didn't lose it after all. I like that. In fact, I want to do it because I'm planning on doing that for a Valentine's banquet here in a few days. And hopefully it'll go that well. Amen. I'm glad, thank God, that that love that God has for us is never ending. I'm glad, thank God, He always loves us. I want you to take your Bibles quickly. I'll try to get you out of here in about 10 minutes, 8 o'clock, because I just want to give you some thoughts from the Bible. I want you to turn with me to the book of 1 John. I'd try to figure first what I was going to. I have those senior moments every now and then. But in 1 John, chapter 5, if you want to know whether you're saved or not, the answer is in verse 12. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. Do you have Jesus? If you don't have Jesus, you don't have life, because John 1 said in Him was life. And the life was the light of men. He is the life. It's found in Jesus. In that precious heart of His. Thank God He loved us. Gave Himself for us. And I know a multitude of folks that says nobody can know for sure. Now let me tell you something. When you find somebody that says that, you found somebody who probably isn't saved, because they don't know for sure. Now, how does it stack up with the Bible? Let's read the next verse, verse 13. These things, in other words, the things that are written here in the Bible, have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may doubt and question and wonder. No. It didn't say that, did it? It said that ye may K-N-O-W know. Know what? Know that you have eternal life. You have a life that's going to last forever. It's eternal. And if you've never believed on Him, if you'll believe on Him, then you'll have that. So He said, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. Clearly, God's Word teaches that we need to know. Through the Word of God, you can know that you're saved. I want to preach to you tonight on something I just call I'm going through. I know I am. I have a no-so salvation. I know I'm saved, and you can too. You can know that you're saved. You see, I know what I've got, and I wouldn't trade what I've got for what you've got, because I know what I've got, and I don't know what you've got. But if you've got what I've got, you wouldn't trade what you've got for what I've got, because you know what you've got, and you don't know what I've got. Isn't that plain? Yeah. Hey, I'm so sure I'm saved. If Jesus came back tonight to only rapture one of us, it'd have to be me. Amen. I hope you're that sure. I think about when my dad was in the Veterans Hospital in Nashville before he went to be with the Lord. I got on the elevator, and here came an old man down the corridor and got on the elevator with us. He looked like he could have fought in the War of 1812. I mean, he was about gone, and he's huffing and puffing and looked like ready just to give up the ghost. And I couldn't resist asking the old man. I said, "Sir, let me just ask you, do you know Jesus?" Well, when people know Jesus, they don't mind telling you. I remember how a smile came across that old man's face. He's about ready to do a jig. He stood up and he said, straight, and he said, "Son, let me tell you about it. Yes, he saved an old wretch like me, and I'm going to heaven. And not only that, he saved my wife. He saved all my children. It's been a wonderful life living for Jesus." And he went on and on, and I'm still getting goosebumps. I got them goosebumps. They're really glory bumps, I guess, you know. But I got them then, too, when he was talking and testifying. Hallelujah. I was so glad I asked him, just because I'm glad I could hear his testimony. Amen. He let me know he was going through. Now, let me quickly just give you some thoughts about how not to know you're going through. If you want to know for sure you're going to heaven, as the Bible says you can and you ought to, realize tonight it's not by baptism. Go to the Bible, and I believe old Pilate would tell you no. You say, why is that? He's probably the first man in history that went to the water when he could have had the blood. Matthew 27, he washed his hands before the multitude and said, "I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it." Thing is, they couldn't see to it. Only God could see to it. But oh, he washed his hands. He was trying to wash his hands of the whole matter, but he's like so many others that just want to clean up their lives and think that'll be good enough. But I believe tonight, if we could go down into the regions below and to hell itself, we'd find Pilate still crying out, "The blood, it's still there." By the way, that precious blood was shed for you to the extent that if you've rejected it, it's as much on your hands as it was on Pilate's. That blood's on either on your hands or it's on your heart. It's not by baptism. It's not by works. If I wanted to find somebody in the Bible to ask them about it, I guess I'd go find old Nicodemus in John chapter 3. He was one of the rulers of the Jews. But you know what Jesus told him? "Except ye be ye," he's telling you, "unless you, except ye be born again, you can't even see the kingdom of God." Oh, he had all kinds of good works, I'm sure. But Titus 3:5 said, "It's not by works of righteousness which we have done. It's just by his mercy that he saved us with the washing, regeneration, renewing of the Holy Ghost." It's not by our works. It's not by our baptism. It's not by your religion. I remember Paul, perhaps one of the most religious men in the Bible. He was so zealous in the Jewish religion, he was going around putting Christians to jail and putting them to death. He stood by while they stoned Stephen to death. He had all kinds of religion. In fact, he told them one day at Mars Hill, he looked around all the things they were worshiping. In Acts 17, he said, in verse 22, "Ye are all too superstitious." Now that word superstitious there, basically you say you're too religious. They were worshiping everything. And in case they missed one, they even had an altar set up to the unknown God. Now obviously they didn't know him, so Paul said, "Let me tell you about him." Because you can know him. Amen. Yeah, Paul was very religious. And I'm going through, but it's not by my religion. Religion won't get it. I don't care how religious you are. Let me tell you what Paul said later in Philippians chapter 3. He said in Philippians chapter 3, but verse 7, but what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. You see, he thought his religion and his good works and everything he had done would get him to heaven. He said, I threw all that away. How I wish you'd do that tonight. Throw everything else away and just trust Jesus. He said, yea, doubtless I count all things, every bit of it, but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, refuse, manure, if you will. Come on. I can't help but think about Harry Truman. Harry Truman was making a speech one day and he said something about manure. And some uppity lady, highly refined, goes to Bess, his wife, told Bess Truman, said, can you not control him? Can you not get him to use such coarse words as manure? Beth looked at that woman and said, shucks, lady, it's taken me 30 years to get him to say manure. Go ahead, let your mind wander. It's all right. He said, I count it all but dung that I might win Christ. You see, you can't have Jesus as long as you're clinging to something else. Count it all but dung. And I love this. He said, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God, by faith that I may know him. Do you know him? Have you trusted Jesus? You see, friend, it's not by baptism. Pilate says no. It's not by works. Nicodemus says no. It's not by religion. Paul would say no. Let me give you another one real quick. It's not by holding out. Oh, I'm just going to hold on. Go back sometime to Genesis and the day, time of the flood. And in Genesis chapter 7, verse 1, God told Noah, come thou and all thy family into the ark. How long do you think he'd have lasted if he decided just to nail nails in the side of the ark and hold on? He'd have drowned with the rest of the crew. But God didn't tell him to hang on. He said, get in the ark. And that ark is Jesus. Amen. Just like Paul just said, that I might be found in him. Are you in him? Do you really know Jesus? Some people say, well, I'm going through because I'm an American. Guess what? Ask Abraham. You'd find out that Abraham had to trust Jesus too. He's the father of the Jew. And Abraham had to trust God. And the Bible tells us about that in Romans chapter 4 so clearly. What shall we say then? That Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found. For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God. And what saith the Scripture? Well, how did Abraham get saved? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. God saw him as righteous because of his faith. In fact, he said to us too, now to him that worketh not, that worketh is a reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. But unto him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Well, that's pretty clear, isn't it? You can't be good enough to go to heaven. Even Abraham had to believe God, and you have to believe God too. Would you believe him tonight? Would you take God at his word? Now, once again, let me give you one more real quick. Somebody will say, well, I'm not so bad. I can't tell you how rotten you are. You know who would tell you that's not the way to go through? Old David. Even though he's recorded as being a man after God's own heart, in Psalm 51, he said, in sin my mother conceived me. Man, he came into this world a sinner. You did too. And if you don't trust Jesus, you'll go out of this world a sinner, lost forever. I told you I'm going through. Let me give you one verse and I'm closing. The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, that the wages of sin is death. But the gift, salvation is a gift. You can't pay for it. You can't buy it. You don't work to get it. It's a gift. Now, you're either going to pay the wages of sin, which is death, die and go to hell, or you're going to receive the free gift. You say, how do I get that free gift? He said, that gift of God is eternal life. You want eternal life? You can have it. It's a gift. Don't try to work for it. Don't try to pay for it. Just accept the gift. And I said, I'm going through. Here's the reason. He said, the gift of God is eternal life through Christ our Lord. How do I know I'm going through? I told you before we ever started. It's because of Jesus. I'm going through Christ my Lord. How you plan on getting to heaven? Don't tell me you're good enough. You're not. There's none good. No, not one. Don't tell me I'm religious. I'm a Baptist. There'll be enough Baptists in hell to have a Bible conference. Friend, it's not a matter of what you've done. It's have you trusted what Jesus did for you on that cross? I got saved because of Romans 5:8. I'm glad, thank God, it was there that God spoke to me and I got saved. Before I even got to the end and prayed or did anything, I realized Romans 5:8 that God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I'm sure I'd read that verse many times, and I'm sure I just read it, Christ died for us. But this time I saw it differently. Christ died for us. When I should have died, he died on Calvary's cross. Hallelujah. Now I'm going to live forever. Oh, this old body will lay down and die. But the real Bobby, you know what? You don't know the real Bobby. The real Bobby walks right. The real Bobby's a lot smarter than this one. I know it'd be hard, but he's even better looking. What'd you say back there? But you see, God doesn't see me as you see me. He sees me in Jesus Christ, his beloved, the perfect Son of God. And that he sees me that way too. Hallelujah. Why don't you trust Jesus? Everything you've seen tonight points you to him. You know what Hebrews 12 said in verse 2? Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. He not only authored it, he finished it. On the cross he cried, it is finished. And if you want to go through, you can. You can go through to heaven one way. Through Christ our Lord. through trust in Jesus Christ. He said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And in case you don't understand what he's trying to tell you, no man cometh unto the Father but by me. If you're here tonight and you're not saved, there'll never be a better time than right now. The pastor will be waiting down here at the altar. I'm here. Come on down one of these three aisles and tell him or me, I need to trust Jesus, or I need to be saved. We'll have someone take the Bible if you need that. You may already know everything you need to know. You say, I realize Jesus died to pay for my sin, and now I'm free. Because if the Son hath made you free, you're free indeed. Would you come? You know, when I say things like that while they're getting ready, I'm reminded of a revival meeting I was in one time, and I was up on the platform up here with the pastor, and people were coming in, and a lady came in through the back door back there, and when she did, the pastor leaned over to me and he said, oh, Brother Bobby, he said, we've been trying to get her to church. Said, pray for her. Said, she needs to be saved. I said, sure. And I proceeded to, in my heart, pray for her. In fact, the whole time I was preaching, in the back of my mind, my heart, I was praying for her. I hate to admit it, but I probably preached to her more than I would have liked to, but she's on my heart, my mind. Invitation time, and the altar was filled up. Every altar worker had somebody that they were dealing with. Pastor was busy dealing with somebody. I'm still up here like I am right now, but I look back there, and that woman stepped out. She came down the aisle. Of course, I jumped down, went over there, met her. I shook her hand. I said, I'm so glad you came. I said, you need to be saved? And she said, no, preacher, I am saved.
Amen.
Now, this is the only time that I remember that it ever happened to me quite like this. I said, you're saved? I said, are you sure? I said, no doubt about it. No doubt about it. I know I'm saved. I know when I die, I'm going to heaven. Well, I knew what the preacher had told me. He told me she wasn't saved. I couldn't do a whole lot, but I didn't want to let that go. I asked her, I said, well, tell me, when did you get saved? You know what she told me? She said, just a few minutes ago, sitting back there in that pew.
Amen.
She said, I believe what you were saying. I believe that Jesus died for me.
Amen.
And I trusted him as my Savior. I said, well, why are you coming? She said, I just want everybody to know.
Amen.
He that believeth shall not be ashamed. Amen. So the book says. If you really believe on the Lord, you ought to let us rejoice with you. Amen. Do you really know? You say, preacher, I'm not sure. Heads bowed. Father, Lord, we've done everything tonight imaginable to try to convey the message of salvation and the gospel, that good news. Lord, somebody here tonight, I'm sure, needs to come down one of these aisles and say, yes, I believe it. Tonight, I'm throwing away everything else that I've ever depended on, and I'm just trusting Jesus. The old song our brother's playing right now is a song that says, only trust Him. Lord, may somebody do that tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. You need to come. Come on. What page is it, brother?
Number 277.
277. Come every soul, my sin oppressed, whose there's mercy. Let's stand to our feet. Come on, stand up. He'll surely give you rest. How? By trusting in His word. Do that. Understand how you could ever reject that kind of love. 55 years ago, I realized what He did for me. Tonight, if you realize what He's done for you, will you say, hey, I'm trusting Him. I'm trusting Him. You're supposed to turn those things off, preacher. I'm glad it's Him instead of me. It's been mine a few times. Amen. I can pick on Brother Slade, but hey, how about you? If you've never trusted Jesus, it's the last night of this meeting. We've had a young lady saved first service. That'd sure be good for you to get saved on this last service. You say, well, preacher, I don't go to church here. That's all right. I've never seen a bad place to get saved.
Amen.
You can go back your church and tell your preacher, hey, I got saved Friday night in a revival meeting. And I guarantee you, if he's the right kind of man of God, he'll say, hallelujah. He'll be glad. If he doesn't, come back over here. You can find a good home over here. Amen. Come then and join this holy band. And on to glory go. Sing that last verse. Come then and join. Come.